Well, Randy, could you go over what some of the key assumptions are that must be challenged based on these experiments?
Well, perhaps the most important thing is that when people are thinking about the nature of memory, they should stop thinking about the kind of Pavlovian conditioning experiments which have dominated neurobiological thinking about memory, and think about the demands on memory that are made by dead reckoning and by this food caching behavior and by innumerable other behavioral examples of the same kind. None of these examples is mysterious if you grant the animal rewrite a memory. All of these examples are not computationally mysterious. It wouldn't be difficult to simulate these performances in a conventional computer. But it's very important to understand that the reason it would not be difficult is that we understand very well how to represent locations. We understand very well how to encode food types and so on. Most importantly, we understand how to encode that information physically in a computationally accessible memory in a conventional computer. There's no mystery about it. But if you try to do the same thing in a neural net, if you throw away the baby in the bath, namely the read-write memory mechanism that is so fundamentally important in a modern computer, then trying to build a machine that can do what the jays are doing or do what the ant is doing when it dead reckons, then it becomes extremely difficult. So the most important thing is to focus our efforts, our experimental and theoretical efforts, on trying to imagine what the physical realization of such a mechanism, that is a read-write memory, must be in nervous systems. We argue in the book that this mechanism is as basic to computation as genes are to life. Understanding this memory mechanism, the read-write memory mechanism, until we understand that mechanism, we have no hope of understanding how the brain computes, because that kind of memory is central to computation. This is the central argument of the book. And at the moment, we do not know what that mechanism is in the brain. We argue that there's good reason to think that it will prove to be universal, just as DNA is universal. That is, that it performs a basic, simple, foundational function, namely carrying information forward in time. There's no reason why a mechanism that works in one domain or one context wouldn't work in any other just as well. And therefore, there's no reason to assume that it's not a universal mechanism.